Rock. Engines have stopped, and we are unable to get them started at the moment.
25 years ago, a cargo ship called the Union Star suffered engine failure off the coast of Cornwall. In hurricane winds and 60-foot waves, the Penley lifeboat set forth to try and rescue the ship's crew. 8 men, all volunteers, made the ultimate sacrifice in one of the greatest disasters in lifeboat history.
I look back on it and I see those men on the rails and the efforts they did in the rocks. And you can't imagine the bravery of people like that.
Despite the fact it's 25 years, you know, she went out and she's still out. And there's that gap in people's lives and feelings that I think will never go away while the people alive who experienced it.
You know, I used to long as a journalist that I would get a world exclusive. I got my wish, but it broke my heart.
In the far south of Cornwall, just a few miles from Land's End, lies a place called Mousel. The events that happened here 25 years ago changed this small village forever, scarring the lives of those left behind. In 1981, Mousel was a close-knit fishing community, at the heart of which was the Penley lifeboat. Based a mile from Mousel off Penley Point, she was called the Solomon Brown, and she was the pride and joy of the village.
The Solomon Brown was a wooden Watson-class lifeboat. We were quite pleased with her because she'd been recently refitted, and we thought that she was the state-of-the-art boat. But it was a class of boat that was stationed all around the country.
When I was growing up, the lifeboat was a big part of the village. Mousel was just starting to become a tourist village. It's more, there's, you know, more locals living here, and it's just something you always wanted to do. I always wanted to be on the lifeboat. Because I remember I used to run it when I was a child and help them scrub it down and things like that.
Most of the crew were born and bred in Mousel. Many of them were fishermen, and they were all devoted volunteers. They were led by the coxswain, Trevelyan Richards.
You're still getting the family element in lifeboat crews, fathers, sons and grandsons and that sort of thing?
Yes, we've got one or two of them here in our present crew.
Where do they come from in the main? What sort of profession are they?
Well, they're mostly fishermen and they come to the same village as what I do. And if they're not fishermen, they have connections with the sea. So I'm pretty lucky in a way here that I've got a crew like they are.
Trevelyan was a good coxswain. He was a character in his way and set in his ways, fisherman all his life.
I think we ought to establish, right, although you are the coxswain, you've got a full-time job as a trawler skipper, haven't
That's
you?
That's right, yes. This is just a part-time job.
I think he was in the Home Guard when the war was on, but as a coxswain, he was an extremely nice man.
I think in every community, you always get a nucleus of people. They all stand above the rest in what they do because they can take any flak from anyone and they don't really care, you know, and they'll always march on what they think is true. I think Trevelyan's up in the top notch with them.
Nobody would contradict him, you know, he was the boss. He was a hell of a character as well, you know, he could be quite hard on them or he could be really, you know, I mean, they could be pretty wild at times. They knew how to have fun.
On the night of the 19th of December, 1981, Mousel was all set for Christmas. The village had a unique way of marking the festive season.
Christmas is a big thing in Mousel, and we have the local Christmas lights on every year, and it is a big celebration. We have a thing called Tom Bocock's Eve, which is the day before Christmas Eve, so it's the 23rd of December,
when all the local fishermen and seamen get together and have a, well, like a great big party, if you like, really, it's good, and it was a big thing in Mosel.
Everybody was drinking, laughing, joking. Darts had just started, I think. I'd just done the draw for that, and everyone was laughing and saying, "Cool, how'd you come to pick me out against so-and-so, like, you know?"
Whilst people were enjoying themselves, outside, the weather was gradually deteriorating.
It had gone from a high wind to this extraordinarily screaming wild gale in a very, very short time. It had a sort of strange note in the wind, and I'm not making this up, it really did. It was a screaming sort of noise, which I've never heard of.
As the weather worsened, the car was struggling with engine failure.
And there are 8 people aboard. 8 people,
very pleased. Roger, 8 vessels on board. What type of vessel are you, please, Union Star?
We are a coaster.
On duty that night to receive the calls was Colin Sturman.
Well, Union Star told us just after 6 o'clock that he had an engine problem, which in itself is not unusual. We have ships call us with engine problems several times a week, even today. But he said that if he couldn't get his engine started, that they would be in difficulty.
At the moment, we want to get the main engine started, but if we cannot get the main engine started, we'll have to take everybody off and get a tug or someone to tow us in.
The Union Star was on her maiden voyage, carrying fertilizer from Holland to Ireland.
It was one of a fleet of coasters built by Union Transport who were having a very successful time. It was a good model because it was fit for work in coastal waters. It was very low profile, and so it could go up under the bridges of the big rivers in Europe. And they built 4 of them, actually, at about £1 million apiece. The Union Star was the latest one.
The skipper of this brand new boat was Henry Morton.
Happy-go-lucky type of guy, very professional and straight down the line, really. He didn't take any messing off anybody, and he was, a pleasant enough guy, really, I suppose. I spoke to him in the morning about 10 o'clock, and he said everything was going all right, and I asked him, wouldn't he be round the corner? We called Land's End the corner, he said about just after tea, and then he'd be running away with the weather towards Arklow, and seemed quite happy. And I asked him what the weather was like, and they told me that it was southerly about force 5, but it was forecast to deteriorate during the day, and he told me that the ship was handling it quite well, it was rolling a bit.
But by early evening, the situation was very different.
Yeah, we're just slowly drifting towards the land at the moment. We're trying to start the engine, and if we get it underway and we get clear, we'll let him know.
Roger, Union Star, lovely, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Worried how far the Union Star might be drifting, the Coast Guard sent one of their local officers to a lookout point, just along the coast from Mosel.
I got a call from Falmouth to say that there's a vessel in trouble near the Wolf, and would I start the radar up and put a radar plot on to positively identify the position. By the time I got up here and put a marker on him on the radar, he drifted some to the north.
The Union Star was heading straight towards the treacherous coastline.
If you come ashore on this coast, you've got very little chance of getting off, and you break up quite quickly. You imagine a yacht coming ashore on any of these points, in even weather like this, and it'll go down very quickly.
In Mousel, the Penley lifeboat was put on standby. Two of the crew members waiting for the call were Nigel Brockman and his son Neil.
My dad was a second or assistant mechanic, he was known as then, and he would have been in charge of the radios and the radar and do a bit of navigating and stuff like that.
What kind of equipment do you carry, Nigel?
Oh, we got radar, big master set, which is Woodson Clipper, and the Westminster's VHF.
What range? What's your range?
Most people knew my father. He could never be serious about anything. He was always joking around. He was like the joker in the pack. If anything stupid was happening, he'd be in the middle doing it, you know. So, and I know I've never heard anyone say a bad word about him. Never. Everyone I've ever spoke to or come up to, people I don't even know come up to me and said they knew my father, which I like, you know. And they say how much they admired him and liked him.
A salvage tug was contacted to tow the stricken Union Star. But this would involve paying salvage costs as part of a contract called a Lloyd's Open Form. So Morton declined the offer.
Station calling Union Star.
The Union Star, Falmouth Coast Guard, over.
Oh, Falmouth Coast Guard, yes, Union Star.
Yes, I gather you had a word with the skipper of the salvage tug North Holland, over.
Yes, I had a word with him. All he's interested in is the money at the moment.
When he was talking to the tug captain very early on, and the tug captain said, shall I come out? And he said, yes, come out and stand by. And so the tug captain said, well, will you accept Lloyd's Open Form? And he said, obviously, you know, it's a bit early to make a commitment to do that.
News that the lifeboat might be needed began to spread throughout Mousel. One of the youngest volunteers was merchant seaman Kevin Smith, who happened to be home for Christmas.
Loved the sea. The sea was in his blood. He always, to me, seemed to be like a free spirit. He'd go off to sea. You never quite know when he was coming back. And he'd come back and it was like a breath of fresh air blowing through the village.
Well, Kevin was my brother-in-law at the time. I sailed with Kevin many times when I was fishing. A great bloke, a bit fun, anything goes really, you know. Has a massive zest for life.
6 years earlier, the Solomon Brown had taken part in the rescue of a sinking ship called the Lovett. Kevin was a crew member, even though he'd only been a teenager at the time.
Well, you, I know, were on the Lovett rescue, weren't you?
Yeah.
And that was not very pleasant.
No, I was 75, I think.
And you were very young?
Yeah.
In fact, I believe you were too young to have been there officially.
So they told me so, yeah.
Kevin was very young, 15, 16. He'd actually fabricated his age to get on the boat at that point and went out on the Lovett rescue and was pulling men out of the sea that were younger than him, and he was awarded on vellum for that very, very brave thing to have done.
Did you enjoy it? Well, you wouldn't enjoy it, it's a damn fool question, but you'll remember it, I imagine.
Oh, yeah, I always remember
it,
yeah.
Very unpleasant.
Yeah, I always remember it.
The Penley crew had to pull several dead bodies out of the water. They were all honoured by the RNLI for their role in the rescue.
Like most of the crew, wasn't a lot of speaking going on aboard the boat. I think it was all sort of choked up with it, you know. But
I think what upset the crew most of all was when they took a youngster aboard,
yeah.
16.
Yeah.
You know, I'll admit it was a bad job. Every five men losing lives, like what we had. But when you get a youngster of 16, you know, everything you look forward to, and life snuffs out like that, no?
It was a southerly wind gusting up to force 11, which is hurricane force. Even the broken waves, when they hit the cliff, were some 30 foot in height. So I've never seen sea conditions as bad as that, and I've never seen them since.
We're trying to use our starboard tank, and we're hoping that one is okay. Could you give us a light on the helicopter, please?
Yeah, just taxiing now. Should be airborne shortly, over.
Okay, thank you very much. Should be airborne shortly.
With water in the fuel tank, it was now impossible to restart the engines of the Union Star, and a helicopter was needed. The pilot who would communicate with Morton was Russell Smith, an American who was in England on a naval exchange program.
When we first set off, it was only about 30, 40 knots of wind, maybe a little more. Not all that bad, really. But as we proceeded to the scene, the weather worsened significantly, very rapidly, and we could tell it's going to be a full gale very shortly.
Rescue 80, yes, Union Star. 0 5 minutes, sir. 0 5 minutes, okay, thank you very much. I'll have a hand flare standing by for you. Helicopter, Union Star, did you stop my flare?
Hi, Union Star, this is Rescue 80.
Initially, the position was given as 8 miles east of Wolf Rock, which put her about 6 miles south of Tatadoo Lighthouse. When we identified the correct position with the helicopter from the flare, she was only about 2-2.5 miles off the coast, which made things significantly different from a response point of view.
With the Union Star so close to shore, the Penley lifeboat was asked to launch. The launch crew that night were Dudley Penrose and Raymond Pomeroy. It was their job to launch the lifeboat safely.
Don't seem like 25 years ago.
No.
No. No, brave men. Brave men.
I don't know that. Should not have won
a lot that. Of people wouldn't have gone that night, I know.
No. The first I knew that the lifeboat was wanted. I knew it was a terrible night. We all knew that. It was a terrible day in the making. The first I heard of it was the coxswain's wife, Trevelyan's mother phoned me to say that the boat was wanted. And that was about 7:50 in that evening.
When the maroons were heard, all the crew stopped what they were doing and rushed to the lifeboat station. One of those was 33-year-old Barry Torrey, a fisherman who was married with 2 young sons.
Barry was just a crew member. He'd been on there a long, long time. Not sure how old he was when he first went, but just a teenager, I think. It was just part of his life, part of his upbringing, just always been at sea. We'd planned to go out and we had a babysitter organised. Then the shout went out that they were going. Barry went and said, I'll see you later. Then I was kind of trying to decide, well, shall I just wait here or shall I, you know, go out because we were meeting some friends. So I went out with these friends and we were only in the village. He knew where I was and just sort of waited.
More than a dozen men responded to the call, but only 8 were needed.
Trevelyan chose the best crew he had for that job, the ones he knew could do that job, the ones he could trust, or not trust, the best hands he had, the best crewmen he had for that job.
He wanted his most experienced crew that night because it was a hellish night, really, you know, he knew it was going to be tough.
Trevelyan Trevelyan took Barry Torrey, Kevin Smith, Nigel Brockman, and the lifeboat mechanic, Stephen Madron. He also chose Charlie Greenough, the landlord of the local pub, John Blewett, and the 22-year-old Gary Wallace. The eight were selected for their skill and experience, but none could have predicted the outcome of that terrible night.
The crew were all there, all dressed, which was really, you know, unusual for us, because lifeboat men dressed for the occasion, but everybody was dressed properly that night.
I always remember Trevelyan helping Barry Torrey with his life jacket, because Barry didn't like wearing life jackets, and he wouldn't wear one as a rule, but that night he had to put one on, and Trevelyan had to show him and help him on with it, you know. All the crew were around the stern of the lifeboat. They used to always stand around the stern when they lunched, and that night Trevelyan got them all inside, because it was such a bad night, you know, with the sea and the spray breaking all right over the lifeboat after they put the mast up, because the exhaust went up the mast and you had to put the mast up to, you know, before you start the engines up.
At only 17, Neil was too young. But Trevelyan was also keen not to take two members of the same family.
I was absolutely gutted because I never went. I was upset because I wasn't asked to go. And I got to say, the boat was launched. I've never seen a piece of seamanship like that. To get that boat, people don't realise what the weather was like that night. To get that boat in the water was some piece of seamanship.
We waited and waited and waited, well, quite a few minutes to catch the right moment to knock her off a slip.
10 lead, lifeboat launching.
She went down, the sea hit the bottom of the slip, and she went down behind the next one and was gone. But when we closed the doors up that night, Raymond and myself were the last two to leave the boathouse, and the wind was whistling through the rafters, an awful eerie feeling, and there was always that suspicion it wasn't going to be a very good night.
A 47-foot boat is about the size of a decent yacht nowadays, and as soon as they went down the slip, they were in very rough seas, and they would have been completely awash. The decks would have been awash, and even the after cabin water used to slosh around in it because of its self-draining situation. So life on board, even without going on deck, would have been quite horrendous.
You'd have breaking seas breaking over the boat. The boat would be rolling all the time, pitching forward, back, up, down, like being on it in a, well, like being in a washing machine, I suppose is the best way to describe it. The Solomon Brown, you had to physically drive around. You had to like work the engines, spin the wheels. It'd been very hard to control that boat.
As Trevelyan confirmed that the lifeboat had set off, the helicopter was already on the scene.
70 miles clear.
The ocean was very confused and getting worse. And the casualty was on scene, bouncing significantly, rolling in the sea.
Yes, we're we've just managed to get a generator started, so we'll put some lights on for you and see how it goes over.
Well, they only had their navigation lights when they first came on scene, and we were attempting to effect a rescue at that point. And then he put his anchor out and turned bow into the sea. And we asked him at that point, would he mind putting on his turn on some more lights so we could see the boat better and position ourselves better and such. Because it was black night, we couldn't see a thing, and couldn't see where the boat was moving very much. And so he turned on all his floodlights. We asked the crew if they wanted to come off, and initially they were sorting out, trying to start the engines. And then from that point, as the weather was worsening and they were drifting toward the coast and we were trying to get their attention that was happening fairly quickly, they then decided to remove the woman and two children. And that was our first surprise, there was a woman and two children on board.
How many people do you plan on transferring? One woman and two children, are there? Sorry, say again. One woman and two children, are there? Sorry, say again. One woman and two children. The crew will remain aboard until the last of it. Yeah, confirm one woman and two children. Yes, that's correct.
The woman was Morton's wife, Dawn. The children were his stepdaughters. He'd picked them up en route so that they'd be together for Christmas.
Dawn's children came over from South Africa and they were going to stay in England, and that's the reason why the girls were on board.
I think it possibly had an effect on the thinking of the captain, certainly, because he would obviously have this emotional issue to deal with.
It's bad enough just having to look after the crew, let alone your wife and two young girls who have probably never been on the ship before, and probably only been a couple of days on board the ship. They may have been seasick during the passage, so it would have been very difficult. And another thing that I don't think is very well known, that Dawn was actually pregnant at the time.
Union Star Rescue 80, we have a bit of sorting out on this rope before we're ready. Yeah, all understood. We'll be standing by here. Be at least another 5 or 6 minutes. Yep, okay, all understood. Thank you.
The wind was now freshening, probably at least 60 mile an hour, probably more. The waves at that point were about 50-foot seas, and it was getting more difficult. There were times we had to rapidly change our position because the ship was coming up and higher than we expected. And there were a couple times it came very close to our rotors of the helicopter. If that happened, it would break the rotors, we wouldn't be here. So we had to adjust it a number of times because the ship would suddenly pitch much more violently than was expected.
Union Star, this is Rescue 80, how do you read? Rescue 80, yes, loud and clear.
Tried lowering the crewman. The ship was sideways to the waves and such, and the confused sea, and it was rolling significantly and pitching, and it was difficult getting our crewman down.
My concentration was on the deck that I was trying to get to. I'm at this stage not in communication with the aircraft. I'm at their in their hands, and they're trying to put me onto that deck. And I do recall how very clean and new the green painted deck looked. And I remember focusing on this piece of green deck, and they brought the First Lady out, and one of the men was effectively holding her against the bulkhead, standing on this deck, and I was focused on the deck, and she'd got these bright pink court shoes on. I couldn't tell you anything else about her, but looking at that piece of deck where I was aiming, this is an enduring memory of these bright pink court shoes, which was so incongruous in that violent situation.
Roger, Union Stars, this is looking too difficult for Rescue 80 as far as safety is concerned. We're getting very close to your mast, and we don't have a long enough high line.
The dreadful conditions had made a helicopter rescue too dangerous. The Union Star was less than a mile from the shore, and her fate now rested on the efforts of Trevelyan and his crew.
Lifeboat, Union Star, yes,
loud and clear.
Do
you want us to come alongside and take the women and children, over?
Yes, please, yeah, if the helicopter's having a bit of difficulty getting to us, so if you could pop out and get the women the two children and the woman off, I'd be very much obliged, over.
It's like the old saying that women and children first, but I think it still holds now. I think you would go for women and children first, and it would make a difference. Although you're there to save, any life is precious. That's what we do for a living. We save lives. If we think we can save someone, we'll save someone.
We've got four shackles of cable out. We've already lost one anchor. We've got four shackles of cable out trying to hold our position.
Roger.
With a helicopter standing by, the Penley lifeboat fought to come alongside the Union Star.
Yes, that's calling you, Staff.
Yes, message from our coxswain that he advises you for everybody to come off. Over.
Yes, we're all coming off.
When we pulled off to let the lifeboat go in, they were now pretty well into the shallows and into the very severe breaking seas. And we effectively sat and watched whilst they tried to effect that rescue.
You could see the Solomon Brown being bashed up against the side of the Union Star and the crew standing on the rail and reaching out, trying to grab the ship, throwing lines over like the grappling hooks to try and pull themselves alongside and steady themselves.
The anchor was down and the anchor was holding her, but the anchor wasn't holding her steady.
I don't think he really realized how quickly he was drifting toward the rocks.
This is Penrad Lifeboat, Rescue 80. I show it's 300 yards from the coast. The breakers are quite large out here, and the lifeboat is having trouble getting alongside.
The spray and the green water, as I would call it, were crashing up against the wheelhouse, and it was getting very difficult. And now we're looking at 60, maybe 70 foot. Waves. I can imagine how they probably felt on board, because I'm sure it was shaking the ship and violently, and the risk of coming outside would have been tremendous, because you don't know when, in the dark sea, in the rain, when the next wave is coming.
As it eventually went right into the surf, then the Union Star did start to roll very seriously. I would think, you know, in excess of 50 degrees. And at one stage, I did see the Solomon Brown, the lifeboat, literally alongside the Union Star. And as she rolled, the lifeboat came up on her side. So she was effectively out of the water.
Stanley lifeboat, we're estimating
10 minutes
before they hit the beach.
You say 10 minutes for the beach,
sir? About 10 minutes before they drift into the beach. We should go on that rapidly.
Solomon Brown came in bow to bow to the Union Star, and as it was in the rocks. And I thought, this is incredible. What's he doing in the rocks? There really wasn't much room to maneuver. And the wind was gusting so violently. It was like being between two big boxing bags, you know, being thrashed about.
A local journalist made his way down to the cliffs overlooking the scene.
When I first arrived on the cliff, I could see the helicopter and I could see the Union Star being battered in the waves, and I could see the lifeboat. And it was from there that I watched the whole incident unfold.
Union Star, we're going to make attempts here to get alongside at the moment.
Okay, skip, yep.
Trevelyan Richards, he was doing a superb job in absolutely atrocious conditions. The way he positioned and got himself over those very, very steep waves, in that sense almost slowing it over, because you don't go straight. And the way he was putting it was tremendous seamanship. And all of a sudden, there's a huge wave. I would think that the height of the wave was probably 50 to 60 feet high. The lifeboat crew obviously saw this. They went astern quite hard, and I could see that from the cliff. They very nearly got over the crest of the wave, but the crest of the wave picked the lifeboat up and dropped the lifeboat across the deck of the Union Star.
Solomon Brown went up onto the Union Star and was well off the water at that point. And I thought they were all going to go over together at that point.
But after sliding off the deck of the Union Star, the lifeboat managed almost immediately to get back alongside.
In the dark, because it's very dark, you see shadows of people running out of the wheelhouse. And it appeared they were just jumping to the lifeboat. And the lifeboat crew is out with their arms out, you know, to catch them. Several people, looked like about five to us, ran out and jumped across to the Solomon Brown.
They were wearing their bright fluorescent orange life jackets. So they were relatively easy to spot as they seemed to pass from one vessel to the other.
And then before the next breaker came in, they turned to seaward and all these rocks, and I don't see how they actually made it a turn to get seaward, and this huge wave came in and they went underneath it and disappeared and surfaced on the other side, basically like a submarine. And we assumed at that point that he was going to continue going out to sea and head home.
Coast Guard Rescue Officer, I'm going to have to haul off. We're dangerously close,
but
I tail into the coast.
Do you intend returning to the station, or are you going to stand
offshore,
over?
Well, I can't do much once they reach the cliff.
We broke it off at that point, and feeling that we had done all that we could do. And we assumed that the Solomon Brown had made the same decision. And we're going to, return to home.
But the crew of the Solomon Brown hadn't made the same decision. They were about to make one final rescue attempt.
Farmer's Coast Guard, this is Plenty Lifeboat. Plenty of folk calling Farmer's Coast Guard.
Can I do anything for Farmer's Coast Guard, go?
We got four men off, we got four off at the moment. May not see now. There's two left on board.
It's a devastating feeling when you hear that call and the call and the call and nobody answers. It's just, it gives you that very, very hollow, sick feeling in your stomach.
Send a lifeboat, Thomas Coast Guard, over.
Unfortunately, on the way back, one of the first things the people asked when we arrived, as we're listening to people calling to Solomon Brown, they said, "Have you heard from Solomon Brown?" And you get that very terrible sinking feeling that something's gone wrong, terribly wrong.
Send a lifeboat, Thomas Coast Guard, over.
So we refueled, rinsed the engines with fresh water to clean up as much of the salt as we could, and launched again.
In Mosul, Barry's wife, Lynn, was unaware of any problem with the lifeboat.
I don't really remember thinking anything disastrous was going to happen. So, you know, came home at some point in the evening and made sure the boys were fast asleep and went to bed, which is, you know, was quite normal, because if they went out on a shout, you didn't know what time they were coming back. I didn't have a radio. I know a lot of wives would listen in, but we didn't have one set up, and just assumed they'd be back.
There was a brief glimmer of hope when someone claimed they could see the lights of the Solomon Brown.
We continued to call the lifeboat. About three quarters of an hour later, the auxiliary lookout at Penza Point called in and reported seeing the lifeboat coming back to Newlyn. So we were quite heartened by that. We told the launching authority to expect them in Newlyn.
And a whole bunch of people went down to Newlyn to meet her. And of course she never turned up. Nobody knows to this day what those lights were or why they were seen.
Don Buckfield made his way to the scene with a coastal rescue team. They could see the Union Star on its side, just below the cliffs.
There was wreckage washing up and down with the waves, and I saw a life jacket with the light still working. And on reaching the top of the cliff again, we become aware that Falmouth was concerned for the lifeboat. And at that time, I could almost definitely say that that was a lifeboat jacket in the water.
The discovery of the life jacket confirmed that the worst had happened. The Penley lifeboat and the Union Star had been wrecked.
A friend of mine, who I'd been out with, a girlfriend, came knocking on the door. I don't even know what time it was, and said something bad's happened to the lifeboat. And I don't really think much registered after that. You know, I couldn't say anything specific because it was all just. I just remember lots of people, all the time thinking, we should all be quiet. You wake the children up, you know? And I told them straight away, as soon as they woke up the next day, that their daddy wasn't coming home.
For Kevin's family, it was his brother who brought the devastating news.
I can remember him coming into his mother's front room. And I've never seen grief like it. There is no grief that can compare to a mother losing her child. And Pat was a very, very, very strong woman. And what an awful thing for anyone to have to do. It's like now I can see it's playing back in my head like a video. And you just, the disbelief and the shock, it was just such a sad time.
By first light, search parties continued to look for wreckage. Many of those searching included family and friends.
Personally, I was out searching for 10 days. Well, I think it was the fact that I was going to find Kevin alive, I suppose. So I just really kept searching, really thinking, again, is it a futile search, but something new. Hoping that you will find someone, you know.
Started to find bits and pieces of bodies. Once that happened, you knew that was it, really. Yeah, we only found one whole body. And that was Nigel's, my mate's.
In the end, only 8 bodies were recovered. 4 from the Solomon Brown and 4 from the Union Star.
You live and do your job and live to do it again. And when some of your own are taken, it hurts. It hurts deeply. You can't imagine the bravery of people like that. You know, just to put their life on the line. You know, they're the salt of the earth. You know, they're the fathers, the brothers, the sons. The sons of Mosul.
Things like Christmas Eve, we was burying Trevelyan in the morning, my father in the afternoon, and the Boxing Day we had more funerals. It was hard going.
You weren't allowed your own private grief. Everything you did was noticed. Everything you said was written. So it was very, very difficult. You know, just going out of the house was impossible.
The ashes of Dawn and one of her daughters were scattered out at sea, close to where the Union Star was wrecked. Dawn's other daughter and Henry Morton were never found.
My mother took it very badly. She couldn't really accept it, particularly with Mick's body not being found. I don't think she ever accepted it till the day she died that he was actually lost. I think she believed he was suffering from amnesia and was wandering around the West Country somewhere, and one day he would come back and knock on the door.
Fifteen months later, there was a formal inquiry into exactly what happened. It raised questions about Morton's actions and the decisions he made that night.
It was very difficult. You know, I'd have preferred to have been able to speak to some of the people families from the lifeboat, but I don't know, it was a very difficult position for me to be in at the time, particularly all the criticism was going on, etc., and I found it very hard.
His only crime, as far as I know, that he was a little overconfident about how fast he was drifting into land. He was drifting into land a lot faster than he thought he was. And I think he was slightly on the optimistic side about that.
One of the issues examined was why Morton declined the salvage tow when it was first offered.
And when they suddenly decided they wanted a tow, it was too late because the tug couldn't get in. It was too shallow for the tow to get in to put a line on. They should have been forced to take a tow hours before she even got anywhere near the shore.
Now the rules have changed somewhat, and the Coast Guard can initiate a mayday on behalf of a ship's master, and indeed we have the powers to require a ship's master to take a tow if that's what we deem appropriate. We don't have to be a passive responder anymore, we can take the initiative.
The inquiry concluded that no one was to blame for the tragedy, and that the events of that night were the result of water getting into the engine of the Union Star, and above all, the weather.
When the inquiry results of the, well, the findings of the inquiry came out, my brother was exonerated, and that really the cause of the tragedy was various small things that all added up to this big jigsaw, but at the end of the day, it was the sea that done them, no one else.
When you live by the sea and you live with the sea, things happen. I mean, this is why we need lifeboats. You know, things like this happen. I mean, you can't blame anyone. That's what you get living by the sea. I mean, every year there's probably 30, 40 fishermen lost every year around the British coast.
For the 25th anniversary of that tragic night, Russell Smith has come over from America to pay his respects.
My wife and I wanted to make a connection. And that's really the main reason we're back. Just to visit, say hello, say we care. And say we'll never forget.
Hello there, I'm Russ.
You can't remember me.
Dudley?
Dudley.
Yeah, Dudley. And Raymond?
Which man at that time? Raymond.
Oh, we've met before.
Yes, I'm sure we have.
Yes.
Thanks.
Never forget. Never, ever, ever. And, you know, all my children now, I tell them about the story as well, you know, so. Because it is something which should never be forgotten. Yeah, the heroism and the brave deed done that night should always be remembered.
Falmouth Coast Guard, Falmouth Coast Guard, Penny Lifeboat.
Penny Lifeboat, Falmouth Coast Guard, go ahead, over.
Falmouth Coast Guard, Penny Lifeboat, yeah, for information, we're now leaving you in on
the loss of the Solomon Brown didn't stop the people of Mousel maintaining the lifeboat tradition. Today, the Penley lifeboat is based a couple of miles from Mousel, in the fishing village of Newlyn. Neil Brockman, turned away by Trevelyan for being too young, is now the coxswain.
I was asked by the RLI, first by the RLI, to become coxswain, and to start with, I didn't want to do it, because I thought I was too young. I was only 28 years old at the time, and I didn't think I was experienced enough or old enough to do the job. And they did beg me to, or really persisted to ask me that, to do it, so I said I would. So I said I would take it for 12 months to see how I got on. I've been here ever since, so.
I've always thought Neil's the best man for the job anyway, because he's totally committed to his crew and the RLI. I know he's, you know, a very good friend of mine, but I'll always stand by that. As on a professional field, he's a hell of a coxswain.
I've done every job on a boat, crewman, right up from crew to mechanic, coxswain mechanic, now full-blown coxswain with the mechanic. A me first. I think I got the best team in the RNLI, the best crew. But then everyone would say that any station you go, but I am lucky. I got a very experienced crew. Every one of my crew are seamen or ex-fishermen, or they are actually, they're all to do with the sea. So I'm lucky in that way.
His father would have been very proud of him, and he was very proud of his father, and so it was a sort of public thing, but also a private thing.
It's just such an honor to know that they're carrying on in the tradition of the Royal Lifeboat Institute, and that these people don't do it for money. They do it for the giving, the volunteer work that gives life to other people, really. Because they still go out on rescues and assist other people in very difficult conditions all the time.
Twenty-five years later, the old lifeboat station is empty. Kept exactly as it was in 1981, it stands as a memorial to the crew of the Solomon Brown.
I just can't imagine how awful it must have been for them. Having a young daughter myself and young children, it just must have been horrendous. And I can only imagine that they were just going to do everything they could. There's no way they could have said, oh, we can't, you know, it's too dangerous, we can't do this anymore, and just turn around and come back home. I mean, you know, it's just not something they would have done.
I got no doubt in the back of my mind that if I'm on a ship on with six of my crew, there's eight other crewmen with me. No doubt about that whatsoever. They'll never be forgotten. I'm just proud that I sailed with them all. Knew them all personally.